were adopted by Cabinet. A, that the current lockdown restrictions would be tightened, while localized lockdowns would be introduced in hotspot areas, and further opening up of the economy at this point is halted. B, testing in communities with high cases of local transmissions will be done, such as in Luweyo, and they will be done, they'll be increased. C, that the reopening of schools shall be deferred pending a review of the situation, while the writing of public examinations continues. D, that private schools that have already opened without permission will be penalized. E, that government shall have the sole responsibility for intercity travel for those that really require to travel, especially those who are seeking medical attention. And F, that two buses will be availed to transport those that test positive from Bike Bridge to their respective provincial isolation centers. Cabinet also noted and approved the ongoing restructuring of the Ministry of Health and Child Care. Cabinet further noted with concern that some members of some religious sects have gathered in their numbers in Manicaland province for the yearly retreat. This is in contravention of COVID-19 regulations that prohibit gatherings of more than 50 people. This poses high risk to themselves and also to their loved ones. And this is really high risk in terms of spreading COVID-19. Accordingly, Cabinet directed that the gathering should disperse forthwith. Let me also take this opportunity to report that His Excellency, the President Comrade E.G. Mnangagwa, will make the comprehensive measures on the way forward regarding the country's response to the COVID-19 outbreak. Cabinet also received a report from the Minister of Finance and Economic Development, Professor Muturi Ngumbe, on the 2020 midterm budget and economic review, and an update on the state of the financial sector and monetary reforms. Full details of the proposed measures will be met in Parliament on Thursday, 16th July, 2020. There was discussion on the extension of period of paying incentive on maize deliveries. Cabinet has extended the period over which farmers will receive 30% incentive for delivering maize to the GMB from 31st July to the 31st of August 2020. Farmers are urged to liaise with their nearest GMB depots and agricultural extension officers for assistance in the transportation of their produce. Cabinet also received proposed strategies for the implementation of phase two of ease of doing business reforms. The Ministers of Mines and Mining Development, together with the Minister of Energy and Power Development, Local Government and Public Works, and Finance and Economic Development presented to Cabinet on their proposed strategies for the implementation of phase two of the ease of doing business reforms. Ministry of Mines and Mining Development, the Minister, Honorable Chitandu, reported that the Ministry was finalizing amendments to the Mines and Minerals Act. This is to bring legislation in line with internationally competitive, modern, friendly, and supportive law. The Amendment Act will help enhance investor confidence. The Ministry is also implementing the Mining Computerized Information Management Cadastral System, MCIMS. This is to speed up registration of mining title and minimizing disputes through correctly positioning mining titles. And the Ministry of Energy and Power Development, Honorable Chasi, the Minister, told Cabinet that this ministry has put in place measures for reducing in standardizing connection and application procedures. These include standardized reporting from regions on reliability indices, compensation to customers for damaged equipment due to voltage fluctuations, quality customer wiring, and also on availability of connections material. Under the Ministry of Local Government and Public Works, Honorable July Moyo told the Cabinet that the Ministry has introduced the following reforms. A, the construction permit is now obtainable within 136 days as opposed to the earlier 208 days. B, duration of local authorities' response to application for construction has now been reduced from 35 days to 14 days. And then C, one-stop shop plan has been introduced and approval sessions will be done twice a week. And D, the number of inspections of stages during construction, they have been reduced from 7 to 4, thereby reducing the overall time and cost of construction. Under the Ministry of Finance and Economic Development, the Ministry, in consultation with line ministries and stakeholders, have identified the following areas, among others, for reform. Implementation of the collateral registry, lack of immovable collateral security by mainstream lenders remains a major challenge. In order to address this challenge, government through the Reserve Bank of Zimbabwe has taken initiative to establish a collateral registry for movable assets with a view to expanding the range of assets that qualify as collateral security. The movable assets to be used as collateral will include but not limited to agricultural and industrial equipment, inventory and raw materials, vehicles, household items, and agricultural products like livestock, poultry, crops, among many others. The underpaying taxes, paying tax reforms are centered on creating a conducive environment for micro, small, and medium enterprises by minimizing costs and time spent during payment of tax obligations to the fiscus. And under trading across borders, trade facilitation is a crucial element in enhancing ease of movement of commercial cargo and travelers. Reforms involve automation, which will enhance efficiency of tax administration, and plans are at an advanced stage on the implementation of an electronic single window system whereby payment of fees, charges, levies for services, these will be offered by agencies, will be done through the electronic platforms. Under creating a conducive environment for SMEs, SMEs have the potential of becoming an anchor to growth and development of the country's economy through their contribution to employment, poverty alleviation, economic empowerment, and participation of previously disadvantaged groups such as women and youth. The key strategy would be the creation of a conducive environment for the sector through a simplified tax regime. I thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Honorable Chair. And now it's time to take questions, first round of questions from members of the media. Any of us? Yes, please.
Okay, thank you. My name is Kuzema Zire. I'm a freelance journalist. In light of the spike in locally transmitted cases, you said there's going to be a bit of tightening up in terms of the lockdown. Could you elaborate which measures are going to be tightened up in as far as the lockdown is concerned?
Any other volunteer? Yes, please.
Hi, from the my name is a follow-up from the previous director of the Ministry of Health and Child Care. Is there anything that is put in place to ensure that women have access to even after lockdown.
Okay, thank you. Any further? Yes, please.
So what happens now is they continue to stay at home.
Yes, there's a repeat, so I start with you, Abigail.
Abigail Tembo from ZBC. Mine is a follow-up from the lesson on the schools reopening. You mentioned that exam classes are continuing. Is this only for June, or are we also talking about November, is year when students really need to prepare for the exams? So what's going to happen to the November exams?
Okay. Yes, Nwe.
Thank you very much. The Minister of Health, in April, the High Court gave an order, a concession, which government that took to test at least 40,000 people a month. Look at the cumulative figure that has been given by the Minister of Information of 90,000. That's, if you divide, that's about 30,000, which is far below the number that we set for ourselves. Probably, given this rise, how do you intend to fill up the gap that we, the government took in April, because of at least 40,000 people a month?
Okay. Any additional? Besides anybody? So we take it to the end of that.
Thank you very much, Chief Secretary, and once again, thank you for the questions. The first question is from Blessed Mchanga, Heart and Soul, and that's directed to Honorable Matema, Minister of Primary and Secondary Education. He's saying with opening of schools having been deferred further, what will now happen since schools have asked parents to pay? Minister.
Thank you, Committee Chair. Thanks, Blessed. As we all know, schools don't exist in an island or operate in an island. They exist amongst communities, and they are also led by school development committees. So there's that responsibility for each school development committee or board to sit down with parents and guardians as to how schools should be run. And indeed, yes, the schools should be run. Their costs during school holidays, when schools are closed, that's an issue that really schools development committees should discuss with the parents. And the schools development committees, by the way, are led by people who are elected by parents and guardians. So the responsibility of education in Zimbabwe doesn't belong to government, it belongs to the communities and the parents and guardians. And yes, thank you.
So thank you very much, Minister. Minister Matema, and the second person is from Abigail Tembo from ZPC. It's again directed to you, Minister. Since you have reported that exam classes
The exams we are referring to are the exams. These exams are on now, they've been on the past 3 weeks. So those will continue until they are finished. And these are the exams that we are talking about. Like the minister, the chair said, any further developments with regard to the what happens at schools, the country will be informed by the ministry and by the government. But the exams are talking about the June exams. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. And last but not least, of course, is to you, Minister, Acting Minister of Health and Healthcare. The numbers which have been listed up to now are 91,103. And so, Kodisan is asking, in April, government undertook to test 40,000 people a month, and this number is falling far below that number. What would you say to that?
Thank you very much, Kolisan. The numbers don't lie. There is what we call the intention, and there's the reality. There's what we call a model, and there's also what we call the data itself. It's clear that the data is showing us that we're almost 40,000 for the 2 months, which is May and June. But we have to increase our effort to make sure that the number of tests on average as we go forward will become 40,000. In the meantime, the average is below 40,000. But as you know, average is moved. By the time we reach, if we just do 80,000 this month, it means we would have achieved an over 40,000 average, because we're talking about averages. But this is not to try and defend anything. You can see that our numbers are below, so it means we have to pull up our socks and we'll do that. Thank you.
Oh, we've come to the end of this press conference, and thank you. I want